from the studios of WABE in Atlanta. Professor Frederick Opie is a historian, and his new book is as useful to chefs as it is to students of history. The book is Southern Food and Civil Rights, Feeding the Revolution. And it takes a look at the food made and eaten during the civil rights movement in the 1960s, with a good bit of history leading up to that, and more information for the 21st century. Dr. Opie is talking about his book tonight at the Center for Civil and Human Rights. He's here in studio now to give us a preview and perhaps even share a few of the recipes. Fred Opie, welcome.
Thank you so much.
Great to have you here. First, I wanted to ask, what led you to dedicate your career to history through the foods we eat?
I would think we'd have to blame that on my grandmother.
She was a good cook.
Both of them were good cooks, but particularly Grandma Opie from Virginia. She moved to New York when she was probably in her late teens, but when she came, she brought a part of Virginia with her. So when we would, on Sundays, go visit each grandmother's house, we'd stop in Austin for the grandmother from North Carolina, and then we move further south to the grandmother in Tarrytown, and that's where Grandma Opie's house was. So I have a lot of fond memories of growing up, smelling just wonderful food coming from her stove and from her oven, and probably she would be the person to blame for all this.
Did you help her cook?
You know, I think back when you're younger, you don't think about necessarily helping, but when I went off to college and I had an opportunity to have my own apartment, my own kitchen, those are the first memories that kind of just come to you. They're triggers. They don't necessarily, you know, do you call grandma and ask her? No, but you just remember those smells and those experiences. And I think probably more so even now that I'm a father and I'm cooking for my kids and for my wife. So those are probably the things I dwell on and go back to more than anything else is time in her house.
How do you use food as a lens for teaching race and ethnicity?
So I'll give you an example. This semester I'm teaching two sections of a course called African History and Foodways. And in that course, I give the students text about, for example, we were looking at the Akan people of West Africa and in the tradition of palm wine. And what you see is that food will give you a lens into many things. For example, there's a term we call gastropolitics, which essentially says to you, if you were to look at someone consuming palm wine at an event or festival, it'd be like a yam festival, who serves the wine is one thing, who gets the best wine, and who gets the leftover wine, and when the event's all over, who cleans up the leftover of the glasses, the vessels, etc. So there are a lot of things that you can peel back and that you can see through the lens of food, and I just find it a fascinating way to, in many ways, defang the students who think they're coming in just to learn about food. And then when they get there, you introduce them to all these topics that they go, wow. And my favorite part is when we give it a reading, and then that day I'll ask them, so what's something new you learned? And I just love the, I didn't know that. I think that's what every teacher loves to see, that aha moment. So that's my favorite part of teaching food and history.
Do you prepare any of the foods you talk about for your students?
I do, and depends. One of the things that I also tell my students is, when you come to class, feel free to bring food, because it would be cruel and unusual punishment for me to sit there for 90 minutes and have this discussion with them about food, and then they're starving. And the class.
I felt that way reading your book. I wanted to eat those recipes.
So the other day, I came to class with some cookies for the Halloween season. So, you know, things like that I'll do when I have more time. I'll make things at home. I made a soup the other day. It was zucchini seasoned with smoked turkey wings. And then it also had some squash that was in there and all kinds of garlic herbs, all kinds of seasonings. And so I made it. I shared it with my wife and my daughter. And then I asked my daughter, who's 12, So is this, can I bring it to class? She said, Dad, it's good, but the texture, they may not go for it.
Okay. We can see this is the sophistication of this 12-year-old daughter. Let's talk about this new book, Southern Food and Civil Rights. Why is food a critical component to activism?
It goes back to my childhood and watching my mom, who was an activist in the Hudson Valley in New York. And we grew up probably about 30 minutes from New York City. And I just watched my mom, who was an organizer, and she would call these meetings to get ready to do something, whether it was the civil rights movement. She was a recruiter, membership recruiter for the NAACP. And then later on in my childhood, she became very involved in the Free Nelson Mandela anti-apartheid movement. And I noticed that when she would have these meetings to organize a protest, food was always there. And then when she'd have these picnics where some of the same participants in these protests would show up, food was there. And as I got older, and I noticed from listening to NPR stories by people like the Kitchen Sisters, and they would talk about some of the things, I said, I remember that from my childhood. So I began to put one and one together and realize this is an important part. And there are scholars who have unpacked the civil rights movement through the lens of music, and it's a great way to do it. But nobody has done it through food. And I thought that would be a great contribution to the study of history.
I also am reading Laura Shapiro's new book about what they ate, about six women in history. And she points out something very similar to what you do in your introduction, how it was just never thought about to include what historic figures ate, probably for sexist reasons. Mm. You know, kitchen was women's work. That was not something of substance. And yet you begin your introduction with a quote from Napoleon and how an army marches on its stomach. Well, how could you have an entire movement if people are hungry? But whoever stopped to think about this before? Well, apparently the people who were cooking for those people who were organizing and marching did stop to think about this. Would you tell us how, in order to understand the history of the movement, we really need to begin with the 1920s?
I think most people think about the civil rights movement starting with the Montgomery bus boycott. And in many ways, the newer scholarship has shown that this is a continuation and not something that's new. And the research I did points back to the first direct action protest, which happened in Chicago. And they happened around the attempt of members of what the community of that we would call Bronzeville, that region of the city that had A&P supermarkets, which was the first supermarket chain. However, they restricted African Americans and more than likely Latinos, particularly as a large Puerto Rican community that historically had been there, and other ethnic groups, other so-called marginalized folks, they would restrict them to jobs that were not well-paying, janitorial jobs, jobs where you weren't interacting directly with the customers. Now, what's ridiculous about it is that A&P has a supermarket in an African-American community, yet they're restricting African-Americans to jobs that are not in management. So I took a look at that. And I can't remember. Often I'm reading something and it'll jump out at me. I'll take a look at the footnote and I'll go read more. And then I'll go into the primary sources. We have a rich history of African-American newspapers that you can draw on. So I saw that as a significant first movement. And then that movement spread systematically to other communities, particularly in Washington, D.C.
Which ended up with the slogan, don't buy where you can't eat or work.
Exactly.
Would you talk a bit more about the role of newspapers in the Black community? That was, what, 1929 in Chicago, thereabouts.
Yes, exactly. So what you see in most communities, and I can remember this when interviewing my father, who told me the experience of growing up in that town of Tarrytown, and said that there was one African-American man. Again, this is not a large black community, so it's not as though there's a large revenue stream, but there was some commitment by publishers of African-American newspapers who they would sell newspapers to, usually one or two individuals, depending on how big the community was. And that individual would go from door to door to barbershop with probably a duffel bag full of several papers, not just one newspaper. And people would have subscriptions to them. And so they might read the Chicago Defender, just a number of papers that I could rattle off.
Atlanta Daily World.
There you go. And that was one that I cite quite a bit and take recipes from for this book. But everybody would read those. And the other thing I did not know until I got into the research is we all know about the AP, you know, that whole stream of the way newspapers get stories when they can't afford to send journalists everywhere. The African-American newspaper had their own AP-like journalist. And so you could see an article in one paper on an event and then see another paper carrying the exact same articles. But then you would also have local journalists, depending on where that paper was based. So it became an aggregate way of African-Americans knowing what was going on around the country and then therefore responding likely, joining it, supporting it, or mimicking a movement. So it was really fascinating, and you could see how, just the way you would talk about a disease, maybe like mumps or something breaking out, that these protests would break out from one black community to the other because of the newspapers.
Dissemination of knowledge. If you're just joining us, this is City Lights, and our guest is Professor Fred Opie. His new book is Southern Food and Civil Rights. We'll hear more about it after a short break.
Support for WABE comes from WellStar Kennestone Hospital, which received Gold Seal Distinction for heart valve, coronary artery bypass surgery, and congestive heart failure. Kennestone is one of only two programs in the country to receive this distinction. WellStar.org. And from the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra, presenting Bernstein, Prokofiev, and Ravel with guest conductor Ludovic Morlot, Thursday and Saturday, October 19th and 21st at 8. Tickets at ASO.org. Classical series presented by Delta Airlines.
Imagine a future without public radio. No All Things Considered. No Closer Look with Rose Scott. No Nina Totenberg. We don't like to think about it, and yet there is a proposal to end federal funding for public radio. In truth, we don't know what will happen, but we know that you are the public in public radio. Our membership drive starts later this month, but you can give right now. Help out with a donation. Visit WABE.org. Thanks.
We're back with City Lights on WABE, Atlanta's choice for NPR. I'm Lois Reitzes with Professor Fred Opie. His new book, Southern Food and Civil Rights, is a story of feeding the revolution. What was the Club from Nowhere?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. So the Club from Nowhere is a group of women in the town or the city of Montgomery, Alabama. And when the Montgomery bus boycott broke out, most of us know the famous story of Rosa Parks deciding that she's not going to sit down anymore. There's a lot more backstory to that than most people know. And I would also refer people to my colleague, John T. Edge, who's got a wonderful new book out that does an even better job than I would say I do in covering that. But one of the things that we know is that bus boycott wasn't an overnight sensation. You're talking about a year that this boycott lasted. And so one of the theories that I talk about in my book is that food plays a role in starting a movement, sustaining a movement, or in many ways making sure a movement is successful. And in the case of the Club from Nowhere, these are a group of African-American women in different regions of Montgomery, different parts of the city, who decided to use their culinary skills to raise money. What do I mean by raise money? When women and men decided not to go on that bus, most, if not of the women at that time, worked as domestic servants. And they lived in the city of Montgomery, but the clients they worked for worked outside the city, maybe 20, 30 minutes. You're downtown Atlanta and you got to get up to Buckhead or you got to get to Alpharetta or something like that. So how do you get there without the bus system? The Montgomery Improvement Association, which was the umbrella organization for that movement, had to purchase cars. They had to maintain those cars. They had to provide insurance for those cars, gasoline and everything else. They had to pay for that. So how do you pay for it? The women decided they would use their cooking skills, baking skills in particular, and they bake goods. And on different parts of town, they would sell those goods. But they called themselves the Club from Nowhere, so they would not have to deal with the negative consequences of supporting that movement. Negative consequences is somebody showing up your house, burning your house down. If you have a job, losing that job, causing whatever kind of havoc to you for supporting the movement. So the Club from Nowhere was an operation in which they could sell things under the auspices of, you know, we're just selling for our local raffle or whatever for our local community, but actually we're supporting a clandestine movement in Montgomery. So that's what it was. What was wonderful is that I think people, and when it comes to cooking, we talk about Top Chef. People have been competitive about cooking for a long time. And so you have one part of that Club from Nowhere on the east side of town, another on the west side of town. And they'd have these meetings in the evening, keep people's spirits up. You know, Dr. King and other speakers would get up. And then somebody would stand up and say, the Club from Nowhere from the east side has to offer the movement today $75. And the crowd would just roar. And then somebody would slowly stand up and say, well, the Club from Nowhere on the south end of town has raised $125. So though they're working together, there's this competitive spirit.
Healthy competition.
Exactly. And it became a way of keeping that movement going that is remarkable to study and to learn about.
Oh, yeah. Well, here in Atlanta, we take tremendous pride in the rich history of the civil rights movement. And in your book, you include Dr. Martin Luther King's favorite food recipes. I have to tell you, as I was reading that, I thought, this is such an intimate experience to read about his taste in food. And of course, to be reminded that everyone eats. What did Dr. King especially enjoy eating?
You know, there were a couple of desserts that he liked made in a particular way. And what I don't know is, are these desserts that grandma made in his house, that his mother made, or that Coretta, his wife, made? That I don't know. But there were certain desserts he liked. He also was a connoisseur of good fried chicken.
Mm.
So those are things that we know about him. And Pascal's, which is still here,
yes,
alive and thriving, was the meeting place for Dr. King when he came back from Montgomery and started the Southern Christian Leadership Conference.
Certainly no discussion about the civil rights movement and food would be complete without talking about the role of Pascal's. Would you tell us some of the high points of this storied restaurant?
So the unique thing about it, again, those who are new to Atlanta may not realize that, because on the way up to the studio, I drive by the new restaurant, which is white tablecloth and beautiful, absolutely beautiful. But the original, it did start in several different locations. But the one that would fit into the chapter that we talk about, where do people meet and organize, is adjacent to the AUC, particularly Morehouse. I mentioned to you before we got on air that my first job was at Morehouse College,
mm-hmm,
where Dr. King went to school. And I do remember you could walk right out one of the back gates and Pascal's was right there. And so that became an important place for Dr. King, I imagine, as a student, because I interviewed quite a few people who went to school not that long after he graduated. And they talked about that was one of the places you would bring your dates if you're trying to impress somebody, because it was one of the very few white tablecloth restaurants in the community where you could go and still have dignity and have to deal with all kinds of foolishness under a Jim Crow system. So I think he developed an intimate relationship with the brothers that owned that restaurant early on, and then it just continued as the movement. The other thing is that the restaurant had historically hired students from the different universities and colleges within the AUC. And so it became a natural for them to get involved in the movement, because they had people who worked in their restaurant, and they would have an intimate relationship with those students who go on to protest.
And if you looked in the dining room on a given day, you could see a who's who of American history in the 20th century.
Absolutely.
I thought it was remarkable that in the book you say you could not obtain recipes from Pascal's, but you have some that are similar. Is that because there's secrecy?
You know, I think when I look at recipes and any successful restaurant, it's intellectual property.
Yes.
And so you got to be respectful of the fact that if I let out my trade secret, you know, it's done. You know, I'm a big fan of Shark Tank. And when somebody comes on the show, one of the first things that the sharks ask them is, just, is this proprietary? You know, do you have some way of licensing this, or can anybody access it? And I think, you know, restaurants, if they want to continue to thrive, they do need to obtain something that's a differential from other places. And I think that's what they did. So I don't see them as any different than any other smart restaurateur.
Well, it is terrific to see a very fine recipe for Georgia peach cobbler, which is unforgettable at Pascal's, and of course the fried chicken. This has been so interesting and so enjoyable. I love the tone of joy and sustenance that runs throughout a book about a very serious subject. You bring it all together.
And certainly that was a concern, that if I added recipe, would people think that I wasn't taking this topic seriously? The reality is, my first book, Hog and Hominy, when I was doing a book tour, people kept asking me, where are the recipes? And that's why they show up in all the books afterwards.
Okay. Dr. Frederick Douglass Opie is a professor of history and foodways at Babson College in Boston. He'll talk about his new book, Southern Food and Civil Rights, this evening at 6 o'clock at the Center for Civil and Human Rights here in Atlanta. Thank you.
Thank you so much for inviting me on the show.